everybody would stand and sing with us. We want everybody to sing aloud today as we do our second official Wednesday night worship service.
Real loud.
Sing it. Everything glorious. Want everybody to sing.
Okay. Sorry.
Here, Miss Fade is a class, you're dismissed.
Go give Steven a round of applause. Go give him another round of applause. Guys, back to the lock-in, or D-Nat. Girls versus guys. Y'all keep in mind what we've said for us, a little competition, friendly competition. Remember what we said we were going to have based on the count. Who remembers and can tell me what the deal was? I'm going to go ahead and put in Justin Wade in the back. I'm going to go ahead and put in for my 5-year pecan pie because the guys, it ain't looking too good for guys right now. We're going to get a count at the end of that at 8 o'clock. We're going to start at 7. We'll have fellowship worship here. The praise band will be playing. I'll be speaking. And then 8 o'clock, the guys will go back to my house. The girls will be in the fellowship hall. And then we will eat at those two different locations based on the food being served at those locations. That deal was on the pie. That will be done at the next event we have. If we tie, Ms. Jennifer Hoof gets the pie to the face. If my guys win, my wife gets the pie to the face. Guys, I need your help. And right now, it's all we're losing, so it's like pies will be coming to my face. So y'all please invite, encourage your friends to be here, bring them. We want everybody here. As far as the 7 to 8 service, if the parents want to stay and hang around, it's perfectly fine. The more the merrier, we want to pack this place out. So y'all please invite, reach out to you. Hey, everybody's out of school this week. So reach out to your friends, invite guys, invite 4 times that many. I need to help. All right, second thing, if you were in the drama several Sundays ago, please raise your hand. Y'all look around, guys, once again. You see people missing that was in that drama. I need your help. I need you to contact those, the ones that were in the drama, and the ones that want to come into drama practice, if you're sitting out there, Destiny, if y'all want to join the drama, you're invited to on Sunday night, this coming Sunday night. I think the stick routine is at 6 o'clock, Craig Casey. If I could have y'all here at 5, and if we didn't pick anybody up, what we're going to do for y'all is we're going to serve pizza. We're going to come back together as a group. Ms. Jennifer's wanting to talk to you guys, you know, go over, you know, how our routine went, which was very well, and then start looking at another one. We're coming, you know, I think we're going to try to get with Dan and try to aim at maybe Mother's Day. I don't know that official, so don't hold me to that, but that's our plan. But those announcements, please make sure you have this consent form and get this taken care of, okay? All right, now, y'all got blank faces out there. Are you ready to praise the Lord tonight? Woo! Every time I ask y'all that, y'all supposed to really shout. I'll leave them hear you downstairs. Are y'all ready to praise the Lord tonight? Woo! Amen, guys. All right, I'm going to turn it back over to the praise band, and then Angel will be our guest speaker tonight. Hold me, let 'em tell you.
it's so easy to be frustrated and angry and to stomp your feet and really just kind of pitch a fit, pissy fit or whatever. But the best way to show Christ's love and show what a Christian truly is to other people who aren't is to stay positive. Show Christ's love in the way you treat other people, in the way you act every day, even the way that you take on stress and anger. People are watching.
Next song we sing. The words were written for men leading their families, but you sing the song like you're singing it about yourself, your own life, because these words apply to everybody's lives, trying to live their faith, being courageous in their faith.
We were made to be courageous. We were made to lead the way. We can be the generation that finally breaks the chain. We were made to be courageous.
Yes.
my rescue. This song is real good song. We started playing this song. The song really, first time I heard it, it meant a lot to me just because listening to the words of it is just like a testimony. Didn't know where I was going, what I was doing, and started coming to church, and really just when I finally stopped trying to do everything on my own, everything seemed to fall into place. Everything just started going smooth, and it was because I stopped trying to work everything out and do everything on my own. So singing this next song, just listen to the words, and it's called Came to My Rescue, and it's all about just calling on the name of the Lord and letting Him rescue you from whatever you're doing, wherever you're at, if you need to get better, or if you're up on the mountain, everything's going perfect, just praise His name. Just praise Him because everything's going good. And everybody, please just sing this song with us.
Knees in word.
How you guys doing tonight?
Good.
All right. Can the good Lord get an amen?
Amen.
All right. You know, you guys, I think you have no idea how blessed you are to have a contemporary band singing for you guys and leading you in worship. Because I'll tell you, way back, longer than I care to remember, so I'm not going to tell you how long ago it was, but when we had worship songs, it was more like then a song and, you know, dance and repeating things like, you know, well, you can't go to heaven, and then you say, well, you can't go to heaven, and I'll say, in a mini skirt, and you go, in a mini skirt, and I go, well, you can't go to heaven in a mini skirt, but the Lord don't want no girls that flirt. All my sins are washed away, I've been redeemed. That was our contemporary music when I was growing up. Okay? So you guys got it good, alright? Especially when they're singing like me. You know, I'm sure you can do without.
I was gonna
arrange
to do that whole song.
Yeah. Well, it's kind of fun because you improvise. You know, you can't go to heaven in a miniskirt. You can't go to heaven in a 747. You can't go to heaven in a car. You know, and you just keep throwing them and you just keep improvising. It's tons of fun, you know, but I don't think that our humor and our fun when we were 14, 15 is the same humor and fun as you guys. Because, like, when we, our first electronic gadget were Atari. We had the paddles and then the ball that went, doop, doop, and you just, you know, that was our form of gaming. Today, I won't even touch the gaming systems today because it's just, you got buttons, like four buttons here, with like two buttons over here on the bottom on the side. I mean, it's just insane. I don't have the eye-hand coordination and the skills to do that anymore. But I just want to share so much with you guys, just so much. But we don't have the time. But I want to tell you a little bit about myself, because some of you may think that, well, you know, Angel can't relate to me, and Eric can't relate to me, and Denver can't relate to me, and Mike can't relate to me, and Laura can't relate to me, because they got it good. You know, they got jobs, they got careers, they have incomes, they have, you know, cars, they have, you know, they put their own curfew, they go and come whenever they want, you know, but we were in your shoes at one point in time. So I figured I wanted to share with you where I was at that point in time. When I was growing up in Brooklyn, I was born and raised in Brooklyn. That's in New York. And, well, yeah, if you didn't know, right? So Brooklyn, New York. Born and raised in Brooklyn, New York. Well, guess what? It was in the projects. And I was the white kid in a black neighborhood. Now, you're probably looking at me like, he's a white kid? I don't know why, to me, but I'm telling you, I'm going to be straight up. I was a white kid in a black neighborhood. Alright? And I used to go to the cheese lines. It's nothing like today where, you know, our parents and we have using EBT cards and you just go and you swipe in and you get your dairy products and your groceries and everything. Back in my day, it was cheese lines. And you had to go stand in the cold weather, these big lines, and they literally give you a block of cheese. And you were lucky if you got the block that was already sliced up. You know? And then you got the milk, and then you got the no-name brand cereals, and then you got all this stuff. That's how I was raised. And then, even on my summer vacations, we still went to school to have breakfast and lunch. And we didn't have money for to have lunch at home. So what I used to do is I used to go get breakfast and lunch and run, hide some and bring it to the gate, to the fence, and give it to my mom and my little brother for them to eat. And so I knew what poverty was. You know, all my clothes when I was growing up was hand-me-downs. You know, I didn't know what getting something off the store, you know, off the clothes rack was like. You know, it came to me in bags already, and you had to wash them. And it was funny because I thought I was setting the trend because back in the day, we used to use iron-on patches. he had holes and stuff. Not like you guys. You guys not even wear the holes. You like proud of this stuff. But in my day, you didn't want holes in your pants. So you had this like RC Cola patch over here and this, you know, whatever other patch over here and then another one over here. And I mean, I thought I was setting a trend, you know, and when I think back on it, if I showed you pictures that I have proof of this. Okay, the big collars, you know, I don't know if you guys remember the big collars that were like this, you know? And he's laughing, you know what I'm talking about. So, one day, just so you know, get to know who I am. I used to go to school every day. And this black kid, Richard, would beat me up every single day. Every day for my 30 cents. That was my cookie money. That my father went out of his way. He used to park cars over at the parking lots in Manhattan. That was his job. He washed the cars and, you know, do valet. And he would literally look on the floor in ashtrays and people that change, he'd take them. And that's stealing, but that's how, that's what, I'm not gonna lie, that's what, how I got my 30 cents a day. You know, he would take the change that when he vacuumed and cleaned people's cars, and then he, at the end, he would clean the vacuum out, the containers, and whatever change of day he took. So that's how I got my 30 cents a day. Well, Richard beat me up every day. And one day, I'm at home, and the doorbell rings, ding dong. Well, actually, that's not true. We didn't have a doorbell back then. It was just a knock. Oh, it was those little metal things on the clack, 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 clack. And he had a little peeper. So, I opened the door, opened it. Went back to my mom. No, Ma, G.I. Joe. And do you know what G.I. Joe is? Okay, soldiers, they were cartoons. Alright? Wow, I feel old. Okay, so my mom goes to the door as my uncle. He had just gotten back from the Marines, and he was dressed from top to bottom, and this guy was just tight. And he, you know, I'd never met him before. So he comes in, and he stays with us. Well, at night, I hear some crazy noise. I'm like, what is that? So, you know, if you've ever gone to a Puerto Rican house, projects, we usually have those tile mirrors, and we like make a whole wall of these tiles because it makes the house look bigger, you know, the reflection. So I'm looking and I'm thinking, wow, my uncle's crazy because he's fighting by himself. He's just swinging away. And I'm like, so one day he noticed that I'm watching him and he calls me over and says, do you know what I'm doing? He says, oh, you're nuts. You know? And then he says, Mom, this is karate. Would you like to learn? And I'm like, okay. So I practice with him. Well, what do you know? One day Richard wants my money. And I said, no. And I tell you, that was the scariest moment of my life. I've never said no to Richard. All right? So we got into it. And it was more of one of these cheesy wrestling matches. All we did was grab each other and try to squeeze each other to death. There was no real blows. I tried throwing some kicks and stuff, and I don't know what I was saying. But we got to the ground. All right, they broke us up. Day one, day two, day three, day four. And then Richard stopped, you know, he got tired of picking on me. So we kind of became friends. We allied. So guess what? I took a passion to fighting. And all throughout my elementary school years, all I wanted to do was fight. I picked fights. I was just anybody. I wanted to fight. That's what I wanted to do. Well, our parents moved us out from Brooklyn to Queens. Now guess what? I went from being a white boy in the black neighborhood to being, take a guess, a black boy in the white neighborhood. You know, and I was like, really? So I started just fighting away, same thing. Well, my parents shipped me to Puerto Rico. Went to Puerto Rico. That didn't work. But I just started fighting them over there. Came back home. Then I started hanging out at the projects, Puerto Rican projects over on Graham Avenue. Well, you know what? I had a starting startling revelation. I wasn't white, and I wasn't black. So, I mean, this is pretty white, as far as I'm concerned. And this is, well, I call it the sugar daddy run. Well, in the projects, I wasn't considered Puerto Rican because I wasn't native to the island. So I had an identity crisis. I didn't know what I was, who I belonged to. I couldn't relate. So I was really lonely, all right? I can't say I was bullied because, if anything, I was the bully. But I wasn't bullied because I didn't have a place of my own, a place to call my own. I was just alone. And that's how my youth was spent. It wasn't easy. Well, one day, my mom forced me to go to a church with her. And, well, much like you guys, but they didn't have where they separated the children and the adults, and it was just everybody there, and you just had to go and you had to sit there. And then they got the idea, well, let's split them up. So we started splitting them up, and I started to see that there was something more. You know, I didn't have that encounter with Christ as I have today. In no way, shape, or form did I have that encounter back then. But it was better. It was like a wake-up call. It was like, look, here I am. You know, and I don't know who's talking to me, but all I know is that these people are not looking at me. We're no longer looking at each other as white, black, or Hispanic. We're just people together, you know, with a common purpose. And like I said, at that time, I didn't know what that common purpose was. To me, it was just a time, chance to get out. Now, Maggie can tell you, this was when I was getting to the age where I wanted to have a girlfriend. So I really went out of my way to impress the girls, okay? And I wasn't very successful, then. I wound up with Maggie. So, I'm only kidding. I love her. I'm very lucky. I'm gonna get one of those later. But, time went by, and I went through a lot of ups and downs. I've been married to Maggie for 22 years. I've got two boys, 14 and 16 years of age. And it hasn't been easy. And I know that I've been fortunate and blessed and that God has been with me, because being the way that I was and all the things that I've done in life, I shouldn't be standing here before you. I shouldn't have my health. What little I do have, I don't deserve even what I have, because I haven't taken care of myself. I've been reckless with my health. I've been reckless with my lifestyles and my associations and my friends, okay? But I just want to get back to the part where I was lonely. And I know a lot of you guys can relate to this at one point or another. We're not all everybody's cup of tea, all right? But I can tell you that we are all God's cup of tea, all right? He's there for us all the time. I didn't even know what my plan and purpose in life was. And sometimes we let the flesh interfere in dictating what our plan and purpose is in life, thinking, well, my plan and purpose in life is to be a cop, or my plan and purpose in life is to go into the military, or my purpose in life is working in a medical office. That's not our plan and purpose in life. You know, honestly, it wasn't until I acknowledged the fact that my plan and purpose in life was to praise and worship the Lord that gave me life. But until you start to appreciate Him and give Him what He deserves, until you ask to have Him reveal Himself to you, you're not going to have that sense of fulfillment in your life. I'm telling you, you're not. You can look for it all you want, but you're not. When they pray, when they sin, they need you in worship, it's not a performance. They're not performing for you. They're not entertaining you. They're leading you in worship. And this is your opportunity to sing, to rejoice, to clap, to dance, mean dancing like, you know, some TV show where you see, or other, you know, facets of Christianity where they just run and jump all over the place, and you don't have to do that. There's nothing wrong with it, because if the Spirit moves you, that's fine. But, you know, there's nothing wrong with swaying to the music, feeling it, you know, it's, you know, oh happy days, you've been listening to those songs, you know, it's not like, oh great clouds, oh happy days. They sang a whole bunch of songs here that if you really listen to the words, you know, you will have an encounter just on that. I came to this church because of a concert that was advertised out in front. And I came and I listened to the contemporary worship, and I was like, well, I was Roman Catholic all my life. I didn't know what it was to be saved. I didn't know all this. I really didn't know. So what happens? They were singing, but I'm actually reading the words. And I'm asking myself, wow, I'm not doing that. I'm not feeling that. I'm not living that. There's something wrong. You know? Is that what God wants from me? Is that what I'm supposed to feel and do? So I came back the other Sunday, and the other Sunday, and the other Sunday, and the other Sunday, and then Pastor Dan got. And then you got to be careful when you get older as us. If you're not careful and you don't remember to say no, you're in trouble, Pastor Dan. All right, but the blessing behind all this with Pastor Daniel is that he gave me books to read. And these books really woke me up. Just got me really like, wow, it gave me hunger, it gave me thirst for more. I wanted more. And I just couldn't get enough. And that's where I want you guys to grab a Bible and turn to Proverbs 2. Just say amen when you got it.
What verses are you going to use?
Proverbs 2, 1 through 11. Proverbs 2, 1 through 11.
Alright.
I want to show you, an example. This is an instruction book. This Bible is a guide. You know, it doesn't get any clearer. Alright? And then here in Proverbs 2, it'll start with the first three ifs are a condition, and then they're followed by two results. So here we go. My son, if you accept my words and store up my commands within you, listening closely to wisdom and directing your heart to understanding. Furthermore, if you call out to insight and lift your voice to understanding, if you seek it like silver and search for it like hidden treasure, then you will understand the fear of the Lord and discover the knowledge of God, for the Lord gives wisdom. From his mouth come knowledge and understanding. He stores up success for the upright. He is a shield for those who live with integrity, so that he may guard the paths of justice and protect the way of his loyal followers. Then you will understand righteousness, justice, and integrity, every good path, for wisdom will enter your mind, and knowledge will delight your heart. Discretion will watch over you, and understanding will guard you. Now, I don't know how many times I've read this, but it wasn't until I went to a service. I'm not even sure if it was here, but one of the best things I invested in was not accessories for my car, or my gaming system, or clothes, or apps on my iPhone, or whatever phone you have, was a study Bible. A study Bible, you gotta want to have a relationship with God for you to actually feel a relationship with God. Okay, it's not gonna force itself upon you. You gotta want to know Him. Just like the person next to you, you know, you can't love a person you don't know, because love is not an emotion, it's an action. All right? The emotions go and come. The only thing that stays is your actions, because that stays with the person. You know, they see it. That wasn't the theme, but the theme here is the first thing you gotta do when you approach God, when you want to have an encounter with God, it says here, my son, if you accept my words. So the first thing you have to do is accept His words. Everything in this book is true to the very end. You can't doubt it, you can't question it. And if you do, then you have to pray on it. You have to ask, you know, and if you're having problems, then the next thing you do is you call out to insight and lift your voice to understanding. So that's when you don't just, well, I have my doubts, I have my questions about this, and that's why I don't believe it. Oh well, God will give you clarity there later on. You haven't asked for it. Alright, so when you come across something in Scripture, in the Bible, you sit there and you pray, and you look at it, you can't go like this, Lord, talk to me. The fall of Jerusalem, Zadok was 21, that's not applying to me. Let's see. Lord, talk to me. Parable of the eagles. The word of the Lord came to me, son of God. You know, that's not how it works. Sometimes you get some harsh words there and you're like, well, what's he talking about? They're for you. Now, you don't understand it, but what you need to do is you got to call out to the inside. You have to say, Lord, you're the Father. I cry out to you. I want to get to know you. I want to have a relationship with you, but I don't understand. Honest to God, I don't understand. Would you please give me clarity and understanding? You know? Yeah. And you're speaking to Him. You're making it known. You know? So then you have to seek it like silver. You have to want it more than anything else. Okay? And that's the silver part is something that maybe another time I'll have an opportunity to share with you guys. I really want you to understand that we have a party God, a joyful God. Okay? He's not about sadness and sorrows and stuff like that. He's a party God. Alright? So you gotta want to have a relationship with Him through His word, through Scripture. Once you do that, you accept His words, and when you don't understand, you call out to Him and say, Lord, clarify this for me, and you do it constantly, and then you seek it like silver. Okay, you're ready. I don't get it. Lord Jesus, help me. Fine. Hey, Mike, you got a minute? I read this in Scripture, and it didn't really make much sense to me. You know, what do you think? And we'll sit down and we'll talk about it. All right? And then God may have put Him in your path to clarify, give you the wisdom and understanding. He may have a study Bible that you don't have, or He may have heard this in the past, or He may have just read it that same week. And you'll be like, oh my goodness, what a coincidence. And I'll tell you, there is no coincidences when it comes to the Lord. There's a purpose every time things happen with Him. And once you do that, fear of the Lord and discover the knowledge of God. And the reason it says, you know, you'll understand the fear of the Lord, it's not that he wants you to be afraid of him. Like, you know, the only reason I obey him is because I'm afraid of him. I no longer, my kids can tell you, many times I've told my lead at home, just like any other father does. But it's not because I'm mad at them. I'm disappointed. Just like when I was younger, I wasn't afraid of my dad. I just feared disappointing him. And eventually his wrath. You push your, you know, push your luck one too many times. I don't know if you guys got the switch or not, but I don't even go there with what I used to do. Alright? But then you go on. Then you will understand righteousness, justice, and integrity. Okay? Then you will understand. Because you accepted it. Because you called out to him for clarity. And because you sought it out like treasure, like silver. And you have to want it. You have to want this. You have to want this to work. Alright? Eric can only do so much when it comes to the ideas. I think this is a marvelous idea to have worship service instead of having you guys sit in a classroom and just do exactly what you do in Sunday school, Bible school. This gives you an opportunity to do everything that we just talked about. Alright? We have contemporary worship music. If one day maybe your heart doesn't feel it, you say, can we sing a hymnal? All you have to do is say, can we sing a hymnal? And it's going to get done. Alright? This is for you. This, all we want is for you to have a relationship with Christ, with God. But a clear, you know, a clear one. Something that's going to grow. Not just, yeah, I've heard that before. I don't know what it means. Yeah, I've heard that before. Yeah, I've heard that before. But you've heard it, and how did it touch you? What did it do for you? Like, these words did for me and made me want to go to the Bible and look for him and then harass Pete Thompson about, hey, Pete, man, I read this. I don't know what's going on. Pastor Daniel, you got a minute? And 9 minutes for Pastor Daniel, I can tell you, she'd have to wait for me outside for like 40 minutes if that was a good day. We just sat there and we talked, and I did the same thing with I don't know how many other people. You have to want it. You have to want it. We can't impose it on you. When we're singing and worshiping, this is fine. I don't know your heart. I don't know where you're at. This is perfectly fine. I'm not going to pass judgment on you. I can't. I have no right to pass judgment on you. But if you feel the need to clap, if you feel the need to raise your hands and say, you know, thank you, Lord. You really, from you, you want to say thank you. Or, deep down inside, you have an unspoken prayer or something really bothering you. How do you reach out for stuff? You say, hey, man, throw me a ball. You got to put your hands up. That's how you receive things. Yeah, throw me a ball. Got it. Okay, great. Got the ball. That's how you got to do when you're your relationship with Christ. Lord, Heavenly Father, I don't know what to do. I just please, Lord. And you don't have to have certain words. You don't have to pray and speak like the guy next to you. You have to pray and speak like the person you are. And in the same way, you know, you pray to see God's hands. God, thank you. You know, God, you know, I need this, I need that, I need the other. You also have to pray to see his face. Have you ever heard that before? You need to pray to see his face. God, I want to get to know you. I want to get to be, you know, have a relationship with you. It's not all about, you know, dad with a wallet. Hey, dad, I need a dollar. Hey, dad, I need $5. I'd be lucky if my kids asked for dollars. It's always like 5, 10, 15. PlayStation card, whatever, you know. It's really about, it's not always about asking for that. It's always asking about, you know, mom and dad, this happened to me, and what do you think? They're not going to cheat you out. They may at first be like, what is she getting into? You know? And that's a normal reaction, and I think you guys got to understand. You're going to wonder why you're in that predicament in the first place. But it's fine. But you got to, when you you want something, you raise your hands. If you want to offer something, you raise your hands. You don't have to do this. You don't have to go out of your way for everybody. Look at me. But hey, this is fine. Lord Jesus, Heavenly Father, thank you. You're giving him. Thank you, Lord. Praise your holy name. All right? It's fine. Nobody's going to criticize you for it. It's, and like I said, and again, if your heart doesn't feel it, and what you feel is doing this, you know, that's fine. But I just, I'm speaking to every one of you individually. Whatever, however the Lord, the Spirit moves you, let him use you. All right? If you're thinking that, I feel something, but I'm going to wait till I get my affairs in order, I'm going to go to college, I'm going to go to the military, I'm going to get my job, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. You know what? You're passing up a lot of blessings in that time. As compared to you having a God-centered life from the beginning, and let him walk with you through all that, you're going to see a lot more success. And like I said, a lot of you guys here may feel like, I'm lonely, or people don't understand me, or God doesn't talk to me. Well, it's a two-way thing. You have to communicate. Our God is alive, all right? And the only way you can talk to a living person is by talking to that person. He's not going to give you what you don't ask for. Yes, he knows your needs, he knows your desires, he knows your pains, he knows your sufferings, but he wants you to reach out to him. You have to make that step. Many of you have. So later on tonight, if we do a calling and we invite you up here, don't feel that whenever there's an invitation to come up front, that it's only because you're accepting your salvation. Many of you already have. I think everybody in this room has. I don't see any new faces as far as that. But you can come up with an unspoken prayer and say, look, Lord, this is going on in my life. I surrender it to you. Don't ask to be the co-pilot. You know, let him drive, you just be a passenger, period. If anything, God's the driver, Jesus is the co-pilot, and you just sit in the back seat, and the Holy Spirit's the mechanism that's going to move you guys. All right? Please, don't pass up opportunities for you to grow with Christ. I did. But I think that I was blessed that even though I went through what I went through as a child, you know, God still, I believe he forgave me for my sins, for all my wrongdoings. That's probably why I became a cop, is because I wanted to make up for all the bad that I did as a young kid. And I did it a lot for my father, because I felt that I let him down. But there was a bigger picture to it. I let him down. And that's why I have such a hunger and a desire just to do more. I'm not satisfied with just coming on Sunday for an hour. I'm not satisfied with just coming Sunday and Wednesday for an hour. But if you can't get past yourself in thinking about God 24/7, what makes you think that you're going to enjoy an eternity with him in heaven? So you have to ask yourself, is this what I really want? And I hope it is. Well, I can't make you do it. Eric can't make you do it. No one in this room can make you do it. It's something that you have to want and desire. You have to live for Him. You have to want Him more than anything in this room on this earth. And I'm telling you, I don't promise you prosperity because that's not what I believe in. But I promised you the same thing He promised you, which is salvation and eternity with Him. That if we don't know the day or the hour, many of you here, 13, 14, 15 years old, that don't mean that you're going to walk out these doors and you're going to get home. But if your mentality is, my home is not Moreland, my home is in heaven, then you're on the right track. But like I said, I can't force you to want that. You have to want that. And I'm not asking you to be holier than anybody else. I'm just asking you to have a relationship with Christ. He knows what you can do. We've all fallen to sin. I fall into sin. Eric, you fall into sin? Mike, you sin? Denver, you sin? We all sin. The difference is, when it comes to God's love, is that you don't sin on purpose. You don't do it because you want to fall into sin. You sin because it was just a week or just, you know. And if you really repent, then you're good. But it's not like, you know, oh, I'm going to go drink a beer and get drunk. Drinking a beer is not the sin. It's getting drunk that's the sin. When you act a fool. You know, you're at the age of experimentation. Now, I'm not going to condone experimenting with drugs to be okay. But if you do, then it happens. But the thing is not to want more. Okay, I know what you guys are exposed to out there in the schools, in your neighborhoods. I know you guys get bored. I know you guys are going to fall to these temptations. There are those of you that have relationships with boys and youth, those who have relationships with girls. You have to have a mutual respect for each other. Alright? There's a time and a place for everything. Don't rush into anything. There's no reason for it. You know, treat that woman next to you, or that girl that you're with, like your sister. Like your cousin. Because that is somebody's daughter, that is somebody's niece, that is somebody's grandchild. Same thing with boys. I mean, boys don't get harassed as much, but, you know, girls, boys to the girls, this is what I'm telling you. You know, treat them like the precious jewels that they are. Alright? And, I think we should have a task for a lot. But hey guys, really, we can't think you want it. You have to want it. And if you don't understand, you first accept His word, and then you seek, you know, clarity on it, but you do it just wanting more. And you have to. So guys, you know, please open your eyes, open your hearts. Surrender yourselves to Him if you haven't already done it. And if you've done it, want Him more. You can't have enough of God. You can't have enough of Christ in your life. It's only a blessing. It sounds cheesy. That's because that's the way we were brought up to think in society. We think that God is just something like 5 minutes of the day, if anything. No. He should be your main focus all the time. And I know that you're sitting there saying, this sounds cheesy. I'm supposed to pray all day. I'm supposed to give thanks to God all day. I'm supposed to God. Well, yes. That's the truth. I'm not going to sugarcoat it. Right? You have to want this relationship. If anything, open your hearts and ask yourself, how badly do I want to have this relationship with God? And seek Him. Ask Him to reveal Himself to you. And He will. He wants nothing more than for you to ask Him exactly that. God,
give Angel a hand for Tom. Before he sits down, Ben, do me one favor. Angel, if you'll stand here with me. Guys, we want to have a close of the song. I'll let y'all pick the song you want to close with. We always want at the end, we want to come with an invitation. Like Angel said, guys, if you need to accept Christ as your Savior, that's what we're here for, to lead you. If you need to grab somebody by the hand and just come pray in this altar about something happening in school, about something happening in life, about something the angel said that touched your heart, come to this altar, that's what it's for. If you can't do anything else but just walk this aisle and shake his hand, shake my hand for what he's said to you tonight has touched your heart, please do. We're going to stand here. You let the Lord move you as you see fit and need in your life. I challenge each and every one of you, as they play in just a second, to please walk this aisle. And if it's not nothing, but you can just come down here and pray for God giving you another day on this earth. And pray for, you know, things that happen at your school, at your workplace, wherever God may send you. Please come. Like I said, he's been a blessing to me. I'm going to be the first one to shake his hand, because something started to lay on my heart tonight that he said he can help me with. So, if you feel that way, please come. Shake his hand, my hand, at this altar, pray this altar. Guys, they sing, we'll let them sing an invitation song. Please come.